All right, everyone, welcome. It's a real privilege to be here today. This is, just for a full disclaimer, this is a 100-level course, so everybody is welcome, no matter what level of experience you might have. So just a quick intro about me. My name is Ashley Smek. I'm a Principal Technical Program Manager here in one of our security teams within Global Services. I'm actually a 9-year Amazonian, and as a TPM, I build large-scale programs that support our customers. And one thing to note, too, is I am passionate about building my AI skills as well as empowering those around me. So let's rewind to the beginning of 2023, when Gen AI made a full and rapid ascent to the forefront of our global conversations. For many individuals and organizations, the immediate to-do was to learn how to learn and understand how to use this disruptive technology. So how many of you felt intimidated when Gen AI came out and first hit the scene a year ago? I know I was. How many of you had a organization, or you or your organization had a plan in place in terms of upskilling and determining how to securely and responsibly use Gen AI in your organization? A few of you, great. Well, you're in luck today because we are going to be going over generative AI skills and culture for security organizations. So this talk will help you develop a strategy if you or your organization doesn't already have one, and really to help address the skills and culture challenges within. So, what are we going to cover? We're going to cover how one AWS security team developed an organizational strategy to embrace generative AI for our entire team. So, you're going to leave here with a mental model of growing Gen AI skills and culture within your organization, including examples and mechanisms that you can use to put in place. So, first, a great VP of ours said cloud first, security first, and now generative AI first. That's a lot of firsts. But with the sudden explosion of Gen AI, we knew that it was going to transform how we and our customers operated our businesses. So in addition, we were super excited to unlock the potential and the opportunity that Gen AI brought to the team. So we needed to figure out, what was the current skills that we had on the team? What was that gap to create that and up-level our people? And also, what else do we need to do to kind of instill generative AI within our security team culture? So, a 2024 McKinsey & Company survey, 57% of security teams were going to be building in-house capability to bring Gen AI to their skill force. So they thought they would be bringing that in-house by upskilling, reskilling, and redeploying their own resources. 30% said that it would be externally driven capability, meaning hiring and contracting. Well, 13%, and this is just in recent, in 2024, they were still unsure how they were going to close that skill gap. So, I will tell you, our team did a bit of the in-house capability coupled with the external ability. So, what's the opportunity? Companies that set a people-centric organization generative AI strategy will give themselves the competitive edge as more workers and their jobs are affected by the change and transitions that generative AI is bringing. In any given organization, the pool of talent is likely broader than you think. It's not just your technical, deeply technical users like your software developers or your data scientists or your machine learning specialists. It includes everyone in your organization, including your program managers, product managers, your finance partners, etc. It really does matter about spreading and figuring out how you're going to interact with other organizations that you partner with daily. So first, You want to build that strategy. So you really want to understand what your organization needs. What's the delta between your current skill set and your current culture and where you'd like to be? Then you need to define your goals and objectives. So like, we really want to make sure that we have measurable objectives that we can continuously report on. And we need to have that strategy of what we aim to achieve at the end of this. Also, resource requirements. You definitely need to think about, do you need extra budget? How are you adding additional resources? Are you adding certain other folks to help support this? So what is the trade-off and what are those objectives that you're going to have to need? Also, resource requirements can vary, right? As we talked about, when you think about your strategy, like what is that pool of resources you're looking to train? So making sure that you're level setting for both, you know, your technical and your, more less technical audience. We also want to develop that implementation plan of how are we going to achieve that? What are our key milestones and how are we going to get there? As well as performance metrics and KPIs. So for us in particular, it was, we wanted to upskill 100% of our team. But then we also had to think, well, as we have new employees join us, how are they also going to meet that requirement? And then also thinking about the training and the support framework. So what training courses to which audience, and how does that vary, and how many is enough? And then how do we also experiment and knowledge share? All of that really went into our strategy, as well as monitoring and adapting the strategy based on the different challenges that arose as a part of executing this. So for me, as a TPM, when I build large-scale programs, I always think through this type of things when I'm thinking about my strategy. So, what did we do? What did we do as an organization? We started with that strategy. For those of you that don't know, Amazon is a very heavy writing culture. So we do a lot of writing to get our thoughts conveyed in a really constructive manner. So I myself teamed up with a data scientist on our team, and we worked together to really write out what our strategy was going to be based on the slide that we just talked about before with the different elements. What did we hope to achieve? It was really important for us to get leadership sign-off. So not only did we take it to our VP, but also to our senior leadership team, and making sure everybody was aligned towards that common goal and objective. One thing I will say, we did have to communicate, and communicate some more. So what we did is through a number of different avenues. It was a new technology, and you remember the few of us that raised our hands when we said we were quite intimidated by it? We had to find a way to remove any type of fear, uncertainty, or doubt around the use of this technology, but we also needed to stress that we can use it in a very safe and responsible manner. We also needed to make sure that everybody in the organization knew that upskilling to get Gen AI experience was crucial. It's not just for our deep technical experts. One way that we communicated is we have an internal wiki. So within our internal wiki, again, pulling out our common, our key themes of what our strategy is, how are we going to get there, and here are all the resources available. We also had a ML security ambassador program. So we had select individuals that were also super passionate in this space that represented both the business aspect and the technical aspect of each of our business units within our organization, and they acted as just literal ambassadors for our program, helping to make sure when we're writing new narratives, how are you considering using Gen AI? So we had a great army of ambassadors going out to help spread the message and spread the resources. We obviously carried out that strategy and also continuously inspected where were we at with our goals. And we did that through various inspection mechanisms, such as our weekly business reviews, our monthly business reviews, and other inspection points, the leadership could see the progress that we were making. It also was continuous updates against our 100% goal of training and reported that. Again, going back to the leadership sign-off, this is an opportunity for leadership to see the progress made. So what did our strategy consist of? Our generative AI organizational strategy focused on these four pillars. But I will say that developing differentiated capability was really our end goal. As a team, that was outlined in our strategy that that's where we wanted to be. And how were we going to get there? First, we needed to invest in our people. We needed to invest in the skills. The majority of our team actually had limited expertise beyond just some light exposure. And we couldn't lead our customers unless we knew how to leverage and integrate generative AI into our products and services. That way, we were better equipped to help you, our customers. Then, we created a culture of building and experimenting. So for the skills that we were learning through training was just not enough. You need to be able to apply those skills hands-on in order to demonstrate the knowledge. So we set up weekly demos and experiment sessions. So as people were learning to experiment, they could come share that with others that were interested. It also gave us the opportunity to knowledge share across the entire team and spotlight different types of experiments and demonstrations. I will say it is really important to create a culture where it's okay to fail. You know, this is new technology. Everybody's getting more acquainted with it and more comfortable with it. So it was varying levels of experiments that we saw, and it came from both our business teams as well as our deeply technical teams. And that enabled us to transform products and services for all of you. So, what did we learn along the way? It did not come without its challenges. We had competing priorities and limited bandwidth, which will definitely stifle progress. We took a very scrappy approach. As I mentioned, it was two of us trying to transform a large security organization. And, you know, we already had business goals set up for the year, and now we're adding on some additional generative AI goals. So there was a little bit of prioritization, finding what was going to work for us. And as I mentioned, our ambassador program, that was one way for my coworker and I to really be able to be scalable. So that was one way that when we had that limited bandwidth and multiple priorities, we were able to scale a lot quicker. We do need to take a minute just to recognize the fear, uncertainty, and doubt, and the hesitation that we had at first to experiment. And really, I think for our business side of the house, folks, thinking about how it really could apply to them, make them more productive, and marry that with our technical resources, it was definitely a confidence builder for, I know, a lot of our people on our team. I also mentioned around the talent pool. The talent pool of AI experts is limited. It is extremely limited, and it is a tough competitive environment. So for those organizations that are fully going in on just hiring those experts, we knew that between upskilling our workforce and redeploying some skills, we also knew, though, we needed to get ahead of hiring. We needed to augment that gap a bit with having some more deep technical experts in the generative AI space. So it is a matter of figuring out what's right for you in terms of bringing on new talent, redeploying your resources, and then upskilling, and a combination of all. We also realized that learning resources quickly evolved. So we leveraged our training and certification teams. We also built different training paths within our material and resources for our employees. So if I want to take the business track, we recommended these types of courses and this type of reading material. If I was a more heavily experienced user, we took a more technical, deep expert approach. So having multiple learning paths and tracks for your employees will definitely help them get more acclimated. So what do I recommend? I can't emphasize enough, creating a culture of experimentation and knowledge sharing is critical. It's critical that everybody feels included on this journey. Experimenting and building with generative AI and new products and services is also critical, as well as tracking and reporting progress of your goals and KPIs. And it's not just a training goal or KPI. It's not just an experiment. It's actually how many products and services are we using this, and how can we continue to delight our customers with more. And also keeping your generative AI organizational strategy evergreen. I think this is also what some people forget. It's like we set out the strategy a year ago and constantly checking in, but maybe the technology is changing, or maybe new technology is available or more resources are available. So keeping your strategy evergreen is definitely something that's important that'll help transform your organization over a longer period of time. So my message to you as a TPM who built a organizational Gen A strategy for my security organization, embrace this opportunity. It's a very exciting time with generative AI, but just understand there are challenges and you're going to need a plan to be successful for your organization. It's still and is always day one in generative AI. You can learn on-demand skills. Going through AWS Skill Builder is a great way for you and your organization to get access to new training material and starting guides with Code Whisper and Bedrock and Amazon Q. So I highly encourage you to take a minute and feel free to link from the QR code to our AWS Skill Builder. It's one resource for you to help build your training paths for your employees. And with that, thank you. I'd like to encourage you to please complete the session survey in the mobile app. It felt great to be back in my hometown of Philadelphia for this talk. So thank you all for joining. And I have to say it because I lived here for so long. Go Birds. Thank you.